Queridos amigos.
Dear friends.
Y con qué gusto lo digo.
And I say this with queridos tremendous amigos. Pleasure, dear friends.
Para mí resulta difícil.
It is for me quite difficult.
Un recuento.
To make a summary
de lo que ha ocurrido
and enumerate
en estos días del encuentro.
The things that have happened during this meeting.
Puedo hacer algunas reflexiones.
I would like to think out loud
por
a bit.
Ha desfilado en orden de batalla, pudiéramos decir.
In order of battle, we could say.
Desfilado los mejores
we have had, we have heard here the best of feelings and of ideas of our century.
Por aquí hemos hablado de cuantas cosas nobles
all the
han sido
noble things
de la preocupación de la humanidad
that have concerned humanity have been mentioned here
durante un ya largo tiempo
for some time now.
Los valores por los cuales ha combatido la humanidad.
The values for which humanity has fought and struggled throughout this century that is coming to an end have been expressed one way or another by you. The issues that have concerned us most with respect to this long struggle for independence against colonialism, against neo-colonialism, against imperialism, the struggle of the peoples for equality, justice, development,
por la soberanía,
sovereignty,
nunca tan amenazada como hoy,
threatened today more than ever before,
la lucha por la justicia social,
the struggle for social justice,
la lucha contra la explotación, la lucha contra la
the
pobreza,
struggle against exploitation,
la lucha
the struggle
contra
against
la
poverty, the struggle against ignorance, the struggle against diseases. The struggle in favor of all the dispossessed. The struggle for dignity, equality.
La lucha por el respeto
the struggle
a la mujer.
For respect
la lucha
toward women,
todos los
the struggle for
toda la
fraternity
raza.
Among men of all races,
la lucha por la paz.
The struggle for peace.
Todos esos valores y muchos
all of these values and many more have been
aquí.
Expressed here.
A lo largo del encuentro.
During this meeting.
Por ello podríamos decir
and for that reason, we can say that it has not only been a meeting of solidarity with Cuba, and we feel proud for the fact that that solidarity served as inspiration. We have heard here mention being made of the best values of our times.
Y aquí han estado presentes, si no todos,
and we have had the presence here, maybe not of all, because in many cases, because if it was possible, they simply could not fit in 1,000 theaters like this, or in 100,000 theaters like this. Noble, disinterested people, altruistic people, who represent
de la humanidad.
The best of humanity.
Si queremos una reunión de personas valiosas,
if we want to have a meeting of worthy people, of people with great human and moral sensitivity,
esas personas han estado aquí.
These people have been present here.
Me admira mucho la capacidad del
I have felt, I feel great admiration for man's capability toward kindness, sacrifice,
y para la generosidad.
And generosity.
Y siempre que recibimos
and whenever we received a visitor in our country, I look at them, I examine them, I try to understand the way of thinking, the way they feel, and my admiration for so many human values has been uninterrupted. And here we do not have many, many people that we know have been friends and in solidarity and have been examples of sensitivity, solidarity, and kindness. That is the indelible, unforgettable impression that we shall keep of this meeting mainly. How has the meeting developed? With all the people that I have talked to, they all have said that the meeting has developed quite well. It is not even similar to others, to many others that we have had, in which all those who wanted to take the floor did so, and it and became an endless series of speeches. And although excellent, beautiful, profound, and brief speeches have been delivered here, it has been a meeting, a long meeting. If it would only have been limited to that, it would not have been a good meeting. So therefore, there have been speeches, statements, questions, answers. The commissions on different issues have met. Those who did not speak here took the floor in the commissions. And there has been a miracle, and that is that hundreds of people were able to take the floor, although it was impossible for everyone to take the floor. Among the hundreds of people that have taken the floor, I believe that they have, in general, expressed the feeling of all those here present. And that is why we must congratulate the people that organize and led this Congress.
Que a pesar de las diferencias
who, despite
no ha tenido nada the de torre de valor.
Many differences that have existed, has y not been similar at all to the Babel Tower. And although
los idiomas son distintos,
languages are different,
de 106
and países, there are people from 106 countries,
109,
we have understood each other perfectly well.
Si había diversidad en las lenguas,
because although there, if there was diversity in languages cual, and in the political criteria, there was unanimity in the noble idea of solidarity with our people.
El bloqueo se convirtió en punto.
The blockade became the focal point of this meeting.
Sobre el bloqueo han hablado mucho.
Many have referred to the blockade. The comrades have referred to the blockade. Little could be added to that.
Pero, en esencia, ¿qué es el bloqueo?
But what is the blockade in essence?
El bloqueo no es solo
the blockade
la prohibición
is not only the banning
de realizar
of
cualquier tipo de comercio país.
Holding any type of trade with our country on the part of the U.S.,
llámese
be it
technology,
machinery,
llámese algo más, alimentos,
foodstuffs,
llámese algo más, medicina.
For instance, medicines.
El bloqueo significa
the blockade means
ni siquiera una aspirina that para aliviar un dolor de cabeza.
Not even an aspirin can be sold to Cuba to mitigate a headache.
Oh,
or
un anticancerígeno,
an anti-cancer drug
que pueda salvar una vida,
that may save a life.
O que pueda aliviar el sufrimiento,
or that may mitigate the suffering of those who are in a terminal stage.
Nada.
Nothing,
absolutamente
absolutely
nada,
nothing can be sold to Cuba.
El bloqueo no es solo
the blockade is not only prohibiting all sorts of credits, financial facilities. The blockade is not only a total closure on the part of the United States of trade, commercial, financial activities by the United States, the richest, most powerful nation of the world in economic and military terms.
No solo a 90 millas de nuestras costas,
at 90 miles away from our coasts, rather at 1 inch of our coasts in the occupied territory of the Guantanamo Naval Base. The powerful empire is not only close to us, but rather it is inside us. And it is not only close to us
su concepción y su filosofía,
with respect to their ideas and their conceptions, but rather they are inside us,
aquellos que participan, aquella
with respect to the very minority, fortunately, that are part of the concepts, philosophy, and ideas
tantos años
that for so many years they have been disseminating all over the world. The empire does not trade goods with Cuba, but they do want to export ideas, and the worst ideas at that. They do not export foodstuffs, medicines, technology. machinery, but they do export huge amounts of ideas. What happens is that in the past the market was broader and they exported ideas everywhere. Especially, they used to export a lot of ideas to the socialist community, many ideas to the former Soviet Union. Today, the empire only has counter-revolutionary ideas with respect to us. They have a huge stock, a powerful, huge, endless means of dissemination, of mass communications. That is trade, but a trade in only one sense, because we do not have these powerful media, those huge communication systems that cost thousands, tens of thousands, billions of dollars every year. We are sentenced to receive and not to exchange. But that is not the only thing. That is not what the blockade is. The blockade is also an economic war against Cuba. An economic war. It is the tenacious harassment, the constant harassment around the entire economic activities of Cuba anywhere in the world. The United States actively works through its diplomatic channels, its embassies, to exert pressure on any country that wishes to trade with Cuba, to exert pressure on any firm that wishes to trade or invest in Cuba, to exert pressure and punish any ship that transports goods to Cuba. It is a universal war with that immense power to their favor against the economy of our country, to the extent of doing individual arrangements, even with people, with individuals who try to carry out some sort of economic activity with our country. They euphemistically call it embargo. We call it blockade. And it is neither an embargo or a blockade. It is a war. A war that now is not being waged against any country in the world, but exclusively against Cuba. But during these years of revolution, we have not only had to bear with the blockade, we have had to bear the unceasing hostility in the political field, from attempts to assassinate leaders of the revolution. Going through all forms of subversion, destabilization, and even direct, constant sabotage against our economy. We, in these 35 years, have been the victims of sabotage of all sorts. I will not only speak of pirate attacks, mercenary invasions, dirty wars in the mountains, in the plains, constant destabilization attempts in all fields, but rather we have been the object of direct sabotage with explosives, incendiary means. Our country has even been victim of chemical warfare with the introduction of toxic elements, of biological warfare with the introduction of diseases in our plants, in our animals, and among human beings. There is no weapon, no means that they have not used against our country and against our revolution on the part of the authorities and the government of the United States. It is not that I say so. Every once in a while, there are some of those papers or documents that they release or publish after 25 years. Although they keep some of them 50, 100 years, and others they say they can keep for 100 years, 200 years, which is something for the grandchildren of the grand-grandchildren of the great-grandchildren of the present generations, who will one day find out the many criminal acts that they have committed and have never said it. These champions of liberty.
Estos campeones de los derechos humanos.
These champions of human rights.
La guerra contra la revolución cubana.
The war against the Cuban Revolution
ha sido total.
Has been total.
Absolute.
Absolute. And it is not an old
esa
war.
Guerra se mantiene.
That war is maintained.
Y en la actualidad realizan.
And at present,
están planes.
They are drawing up.
De sabotaje.
They are preparing
a nuestra economía,
plans to sabotage our economy,
a nuestras industrias,
our strategic industries.
En la actualidad,
at present,
muy afines,
organizations
al gobierno
quite
de Estados
related
Unidos,
to the government of the United States are carrying out activities around the preparation of assassination attempts against the leaders of the revolution itself. Do not believe that these are things of the past. This is something of the present. And dirty war plans and plans for the infiltration of armed mercenaries to assassinate, to do sabotage, to create uncertainty
and
to bring
death
to all corners of our country. I say this, and I say this very responsibly, these are plans of imperialism of this very moment against us. That is something more. Something much more than the economic blockade. And all this policy is accompanied by a constant campaign of slanders and lies against our country to justify their crimes. And now their main emphasis is in the banner of human rights. Human rights. In the mouth of those who have committed and are committed terrible actions against our country. As we were recently telling the High Commissioner of the UN on Human Rights, with whom we talked at length, the most brutal and most cruel violations of the human rights of our people is committed with the attempt to make our people yield out of hunger and diseases, a people made up of 11 million Cubans. The United States, speaking of human rights, when they began by exterminating the first inhabitants of that country, their autochthonous, their native population, who can forget the times and that betrayal of collecting the scalps of Indians? They killed more Indians than buffaloes. And they even exterminated the buffaloes.
Expandieron el Estado.
They expanded the state
a costa de los territorios
at the expense of the territory of others.
Y se extendieron
and they expanded by taking land from them.
Y así despojaron a los vecinos.
And that way,
de una forma o de otra,
one way or another, they took away from their neighbors millions of square kilometers of land. Only in the case of Mexico, they took more than half of Mexico's territory.
A Puerto Rico lo tienen todavía ocupado.
In the case of Puerto Rico, they still have it occupied.
A Cuba hace más de 150 años.
In the case of Cuba, they wanted to devour Cuba more than 100 years ago.
En países de América Latina.
In countries of Latin America, they intervened tens of times.
A A Panamá le impusieron el canal.
In Panama, they imposed the canal on them.
Eso por no hablar más que de nuestro hemisferio.
Just to mention our hemisphere.
No me estoy refiriendo
a la guerra. I'm not referring here to the Vietnam War or the war in Laos or Cambodia or these other places.
¿Qué historia?
What a history.
Qué paradójico que ahora.
How paradoxical
apruebe
that they now
la proposición de ley
adopt
187.
The 187 act. And that was not 100 years ago.
Ni fue hace 100 días.
Or 100 days ago.
Hace unas cuantas semanas.
That was only a few weeks ago.
Para prohibir que le presten atención.
Not to allow health and education for immigrants, children that are undocumented or their relatives. What concept is that respect for human rights?
¿Qué conceptos, qué ideas acerca del ser humano?
What concepts and ideas about human beings? One cannot simply conceive of seeing a child come to a place ill and that nobody takes care of him. When, on the other hand, you're spending $300 billion in the military budget and in the most sophisticated weapons ever conceived. It is not necessary to go too far into the past. In contemporary times, since the revolution has existed, what has been the history of the foreign policy of the U.S., the champion of liberty, the champion of human rights?
La alianza estrecha con los regímenes más represivos,
the closest alliance with the most repressive, bloody regimes that have ever existed throughout the world. If we think in terms of Europe, we recall that immediately after the World War, there was the alliance of the United States with Spanish fascism. Which was inaugurated with the weapons of Hitler and Mussolini.
Y que costó millones de vidas.
And that cost millions of lives until the end.
No podemos pasar por alto su alianza con el rey.
We cannot but mention their alliance with the regime of South Vietnam and their genocidal war against the Vietnamese people in the south and in the north. We cannot but mention the Korean War, a country that was totally leveled down,
convertido en polvo,
transformed into dust.
No podemos
we cannot
Hiroshima y
ignore Hiroshima or Nagasaki.
Con el empleo innecesario de
with
armas
the unnecessary
nucleares.
Use of nuclear
empleo
weapons,
absolutamente innecesario.
Totally unnecessarily and that in any case could have been used against some military facility, which fell on civilian populations, millions of inhabitants, to establish the era of atomic terror throughout the world. We cannot forget their alliance with South Africa and apartheid. We can't even forget that apartheid manufactured nuclear weapons, and when we were fighting in South Angola against the apartheid army, together with the Angolans, South Africa already had nuclear weapons, several nuclear weapons, and the United States knew that South Africa had these nuclear weapons, and that these nuclear weapons could be used against human soldiers, Cuban and Angolan soldiers. But it was South Africa, it was racism and fascism. They that have created a tremendous scandal and have even threatened with war because of a supposed idea that the North Koreans wanted to develop nuclear weapons, and they allowed and they consented, and through indirect means they facilitated the building of nuclear weapons on the part of South Africa. But if we come closer here to our continent in more recent times, who can forget Nicaragua's dirty war? Organized through armed mercenaries that meant the death of tens of thousands of Nicaraguans and the mutilation of thousands of Nicaraguans. Who can forget that? The champion of liberty, the champion of human rights. Who can forget the dirty war in El Salvador, the support of the U.S. government for a genocidal government, to which they delivered tens of millions in sophisticated weapons to crush the rebellion of the people? A war that meant more than 50,000 deaths. And why did the Malvinas War take place, or Falkland Islands? Simply because the United States used Battalion 401 of Special Forces in Argentina for their dirty war against Nicaragua and their dirty war in El Salvador. And they rendered such brilliant and pleasant service to the United States that they thought it was time to occupy Malvinas. This has nothing to do with the right of Argentina to the Malvinas, which we have always defended. Always. But the Argentinian military believed that time had come to collect for the services they were rendering the United States in Central America, so that they would support them in that military adventure. It was an adventure, in the end, because that is not a way to wage war. Wars are either waged or not, and if you're and if they are done, they must be taken to the last consequences if there are just wars. They invaded the Malvinas, but the United States was then in a situation of choosing between their allies, their predecessors, the British, and the military Argentinian government. And they, their option was the British, and they supported them. Who can forget?
En Guatemala.
What happened in Guatemala?
Desde la época del gobierno de Arbenz.
Since the period of Arbenz, in the 50s.
Donde un gobierno popular,
where a government of the people, elected by the people,
intenta hacer una reforma
attempted
agraria.
To have an agrarian reform to help the peasants and the native communities. So then, immediately, a dirty war, the invasion of mercenaries, and then what? And what has happened up to today? More than 100,000 missing. A country where during tens of years, the category of political prisoner simply did not exist because they were all simply missing.
Hasta hoy.
Up to today. Who offered supplies to that government? Who trained that government? The champion of liberty, the champion of human rights. And what happened in Chile with Salvador Allende's people's government?
Contra él conspiraron.
They conspired against him. His economy was under blockade in many different forms, and conditions started to be created for the coup. Which meant thousands and thousands of missing people and people are murdered. And what happened in Argentina with that military government we were mentioning? It is said that there were at least 15,000 missing. It is said that at least, I said at least. I don't want people to believe I'm exaggerating. And it is also said that it is 30,000. And some say that even more. But let us use that a figure, referring to it as minimal. Is it really that little? 15,000 missing people? And who armed, who supported, who assisted that government? Who used their services in Central America? The champions of liberty, the champions of human rights.
¿Y qué pasó en Uruguay?
And what happened in Uruguay?
¿Y qué pasó en Brasil?
And what happened in Brazil?
¿Y quiénes apoyaron a los
And who supported
a los que torturaban,
the putschists
asesinaban y desaparecían.
And those who tortured, murdered, and
¿quién intervino
disappeared
en Santo
people?
Domingo?
Who intervened in the Dominican
Cuando
Republic?
La rebelión
at the time of the
de Camaño.
Camaño rebellion.
¿Quién invadió Granada?
Who invaded Granada?
¿Quién invadió Panamá?
Who invaded Panama?
Los campeones de la libertad.
The champions of liberty.
Y de los derechos humanos.
And of human rights.
¿Cuál de esos países fue hostigado?
Which of these countries was harassed? Which of these governments was harassed? Which of these governments was blockaded? Of all those I've mentioned, did they deny credits to any of them? Or trade?
¿A quién de ellos defendieron de venderle armas y suministro de guerra?
Did they stop selling weapons, war supplies? Who did they not train in these so-called anti-subversive actions?
¿A quienes no entrenaron?
Who did they not train in the art of crime,
la desaparición,
the missing,
y las torturas,
and the tortured?
Y esos son,
and these,
los que bloquean a Cuba,
are the ones that are now blockading Cuba, slandering Cuba, accusing Cuba of violations of human rights,
para justificar sus
to justify their crimes
contra nuestro pueblo,
against our people.
Y es Cuba.
And it is
lo digo sin
Cuba, and I say this
lo digo sin
with a cold mind, I say this
índole
without any subjectivity.
El país que más
Cuba
ha hecho
is the country that has done most
por el ser humano
for the human being.
¿Qué revolución fue más noble?
What revolution has been more noble?
¿Qué revolución fue más
What
generosa?
Revolution was more generous?
¿Qué revolución respetó
What revolution más respected man most?
Y no ya como revolución
and not as a victorious
poder,
revolution in power,
sino desde nuestra
but
propia guerra,
since our very war, our very revolutionary struggle, in which we established principles that could not be violated, because what made us revolutionaries was to repel injustice, crime, tortures, and our war, which lasted 25 months, and it was very intense, where we captured thousands of prisoners. There was not one single case of physical violence against people to obtain information, not even in the middle of the war.
No hubo un solo caso
there was not one single case of assassinating a prisoner.
Y lo que hacíamos con los prisioneros,
what we did with the prisoners was to let them go free. Naturally, we would take the weapons from them because we were interested in the weapons. And we treated them with all considerations that these weapon suppliers deserved. At the beginning, they had made them believe that we would kill them all. And some even resisted to the very end. But once they found out throughout the war what was the behavior of the rebel army, then it was easier for them to turn over their weapons. And in some cases, some of those soldiers turned themselves over three times because they would change them, from transfer him from one front to another front to another front. They would send him from one place to another. And they already had the experience. But the most important thing is that these principles of never resorting to torture, of never resorting to crime, these principles have been maintained without a single exception by the Cuban Revolution until today.
Digan lo que digan.
Whatever they say,
escriban
whatever
lo que
they
escriban.
Write, we already know that many of these writings were written by people paid by the CIA. Is there any other example like this in history? And there have been many revolutions in history. And in general, they were harsh, very harsh, from the revolutions in England, then the French Revolution, the Russian Revolution, the Spanish Civil War, the Mexican Revolution. We know a lot about revolutions, and a lot has been written about revolutions. And even more in the case of counter-revolutions, because of counter-revolutions, they're not even mentioned. Revolutions are generous, but counter-revolutions are unavoidably brutal, and let the communers of Paris say it.
And in the case of Cuba, there has not been a single exception. In the history of the revolution, there isn't a single case of a missing person or torture or political assassination.
Un solo caso de desaparecido.
Of a missing person.
No existen en nuestro país los llamados escuadrones de la muerte.
There are no
proliferan
death squads that proliferate like mushrooms in many countries of this hemisphere.
Ustedes que hablen por nosotros.
You may speak on our behalf.
no citar nombres.
We have preferred not to state names. But practically everything has occurred in our continent. And why not mention the United States, where men like Martin Luther King were brutally assassinated because they defended the civil rights.
Otros muchos. Un país donde
and
se aplica
many
la pena
others,
de muerte,
a country where the death penalty is applied to blacks and Hispanics. In our country, we do not have these phenomenons that can be observed in other countries of children assassinated in the streets. In order to avoid the for them to beg for in the streets. The revolution did away with the need of begging. The revolution did away with gambling. The revolution did away with the drugs. The revolution liquidated prostitution. Yes, there might be, unfortunately, there might be still some cases, certain trends, which as a result of the economic difficulties and as a result of the country's opening to contacts from abroad, they give rise to prostitution, and there might be some hookers. We do not deny this. On Fifth Avenue, you may see them.
But
you cannot confuse them with decent persons. There are cases, however, we struggle against these phenomenon. We do not tolerate prostitution. It is not legalized. There might be some children who are sent by their parents, and they approached a tourist and they asked for chewing gum or they asked for something. These phenomena exist as a result of the special conditions that we're living through. In the midst of all the shortages that we face, economical shortages, when the blockade has become worse. But these phenomena were not observed in normal times of the revolution. You don't see men homeless sleeping in the streets and covered with the newspapers in spite of our poverty. In spite of our current poverty, there isn't a single homeless in our country without social security. In spite of our current poverty, the vices that exist in capitalist society do not exist in Cuba. In our country, this is the work of the revolution. There isn't a single child without a school and without teachers. There isn't a single citizen who is not entitled to health services before they are born, because we began to care for our citizens before they are born, while they are still inside their mothers. Since the very weeks of their conception.
Somos el país del mundo.
We are
the medicos per capita.
We are a country in the world, or
a pesar
the
del periodo especial.
Country in the world with the most doctors per capita, in spite of the special country period. And I say not of Latin America, but I say of the world. Beyond the Nordic countries and the Canadians, countries who occupy the prominent positions of health care services the world over. We are the country with the most number of professors and teachers per capita. In spite of all the difficult situation, we are the country in the world with the most cultural instructors per capita and sports and physical education professors in the world. And that is a country that they blockade. And that is the country that they want to surrender as a result of hunger and disease.
Algunos pretenden que se quite el bloqueo.
Some
a cambio
want for the blockade to be lifted in exchange for our capitulation and for us to renounce our political convictions, to give up socialism and other forms of democracy. Even at the meeting in Rio, which issued a confusing document in spite of the noble resistance of the government of Brazil and Mexico and others, and promoted by some who are very close, very, very close to the United States, and I'm not going to quote name any country, a document that was quite confusing resulted, which gives rise to certain interpretations. Something consider to be the position of the United States a condition of the United States for the lifting of the blockade by means of political positions that we must give up, or political changes. Is there any country in the world that has carried out more political changes than Cuba? And what is exactly a revolution if not the most extraordinary and profound political change? And we made this revolution more than 35 years ago. And throughout the last 35 years, we have been carrying out political changes. And not trying to establish a formal democracy. An alienating formal democracy. divisora de los pueblos, which divides the peoples,
fragmentadora de los pueblos,
and fragments the peoples.
No hay una democracia que realmente una a los pueblos.
Democracy that will truly unite the peoples and expedite the fundamental issues, in other words, the constant participation of the people in the politics of the country and the constant participation of the people in the fundamental issues of their lives.
In
recently, we modified the Constitution based on the principle that the people nominates and the people elects. I do not intend to criticize anybody, but in most countries, even in Africa, where they are introducing, together with neocolonialism and neoliberalism, they are introducing all these things. In other words, the Western political systems, people who never heard of Voltaire, Danton, or Rousseau, or never heard about the philosophers of the independence of the United States. And you should recall how Bolivar in our hemisphere was adamant against a carbon copy of the European and North American systems, which led our countries to catastrophe, to division and subordination to neocolonialism. However, we see how the different societies are fragmented into thousands of peoples, society that must concert their efforts for development. And they have instated the not multi-party systems, but milli-party systems, thousands of parties. And yet we have worked and we have elaborated our own system, and we did not copy it from no one. We established the right for the neighbors to make the nominations at the first instance. They might agree or not, but it is as respectable as the Greek democracy, without slaves or serfs, because in the case of the Greeks, only a few met, and there were very few in number because there were no microphones at that time. The slaves did not participate. The serfs did not participate. They do not participate either nowadays. If you analyze the electoral results, you can see that in the United States, at just now, they just elected a new Congress, where there is a trend towards a conservative position and towards an ultra-rightist position. However, these are the domestic problems of the United States. I assure you, I swear, that we have not told that the posed as a condition for the United States in order to normalize relations that they should renounce to that system. Can you imagine if we told them that at least 80% of the population had to vote? 38% decided at the election, and that was it. And the others said, well, I'm going to the beach. Or maybe I'll go to the movies. Or maybe I'll stay home and rest.
Eso ocurre.
That happens
entre los campeones
among the champions
de la libertad,
of liberty
de los derechos humanos,
and the champions of human rights and civil rights.
Y en muchos países de América,
and in many countries of Latin America, the same occurs. Many people do not go to the elections because the slaves and the serfs say, well, why should I vote if things will never change? And it's very difficult to reach an agreement because of the influence of the media, which is ever growing, and all the obstacles that the popular forces must overcome, which are ever more difficult to pass. However, at our elections, more than 95% of the population turns out, and no one is forced to vote. Not even those who are in favor of the revolution or against the revolution, they vote. They cast their ballot, a blank ballot. But I repeat, the neighbors are the ones who make the nominations. The people makes the nominations, and the peoples are the ones who elect their candidates. So that's why I say that the possibility for an ordinary citizen to be elected are infinitely greater than in other countries. Proof of this, I was talking with the Mexican delegation, and they say that here we have the smallest of the youngest of the members of parliament, and I was admired. I was astounded, but then suddenly I remembered that we have several members of parliament who are younger than 20, because the students at the secondary level, or beginning at the secondary level, participate in this election process together with all the mass organizations. The farmers participate in the nomination process, as well as the women's organization in the nominations of the candidates. The trade unions also participate in the nomination process. The committees for the defense of the revolution also participate in this process. And there are scores of students in the, there are many students from secondary and high school level, university, who are members of parliament, women and all sectors are members of the National Assembly. It is not the party who nominates. The party does not nominate, nor does it elect. It makes sure that all the principles and all the norms are observed. However, it does not participate in any of these electoral processes. Now that is the situation in Cuba, and one of the recent modifications is that each of the deputies must obtain at least 50% of the valid votes. Alarcón was explaining these issues when he recalled in a magazine that he was carrying, and he has the advantage that he speaks English and he's able to read American magazines. And he explained how a man had spent $25 million in his electoral campaign. What kind of democracy is that? How many people have $25 million to spend on a electoral campaign? And in Cuba, they do not even need to spend $25, perhaps the bus ticket to go to vote on election day. What kind of democracy is that where you have to be a millionaire in order to be able to have the necessary resources to talk to the people and persuade them to elect them, and then they forget about him until the next election? They'll never see him again. In Cuba, the positions are renewed. And the delegate to a district can be elected, but he can also be revoked from his position. That is our system. We do not intend for the others to implement this system, but this is the system that we have adopted. No one came here to force it on us. No U.S. governor came here to establish a code here in Cuba as they used to do before. The Constitution, we drafted the Constitution, and the electoral, we also drafted the electoral code, and this is what we have defended, in other words, the right of the country to establish the norms, the economic, political, social regime that they consider pertinent. Of any other thing would be absurd, would be madness. And these madmen intend that for everyone else to do exactly what they do, and we do not like their system. That is why it is unacceptable for us to condition the lifting of the blockade with positions that will affect the sovereignty of our country. It is unacceptable. And it is also irritating. And we actually prefer to perish than to renounce to our sovereignty. The blockade has been going on for many years, but it is fundamental that we think about an event. At the victory of the revolution, there was a certain world, a certain world order. However, after 35 years of revolution, there is another world order. The world changed, and it didn't change for the benefit of progress, quite the contrary. Because the bipolar, no one liked the bipolar world, but the unipolar world, we like even less. At the victory of the revolution, there was a bipolar world. The United States imposed the blockade at the practically at the very beginning, and they began to eliminate the sugar quota. They also suspended the oil supply. Can you imagine a new revolution under those conditions? Of course, they also suspended the supply of spare parts and machinery, etc. However, the Soviet Union and the socialist countries existed. It was fortunate for Cuba, because in the face of the U.S. Blockade and the presence of the United States only 90 miles away from our country, there was another force, another movement in the world with a revolutionary essence, an origin, which was in contradiction with U.S. imperialism. And thanks to this, we were able to find a market for our sugar. We were able to find oil supply, foodstuff, as was explained here. We also receive preferential prices, but we must state that it's not only Cuba who has preferential prices. The Lomé Convention establishes preferential prices for sugar and other products from many countries that were former colonies. In the United States, when we were a considerable sugar market for them, before they took away the quota and distributed to other Latin American countries, there were also preferential prices. As was explained by Laje, 80% of the world of the sugar in the world is marketed through preferential prices, and in conformity with the principles of the political doctrine, the socialist countries used to pay us preferential prices. And this is the policy that we defended for all countries of the Third World, because this was the only way that to decrease the difference between the developed country and the underdeveloped countries. This was a demand of the world, of all the countries of the Third World. And even though it was convenient, because even though we received preferential prices from the Soviet Union, the cost of these prices, the production of sugar was even more expensive. However, we benefited from these preferential prices with which we purchased the fuel, the raw materials, etc. And it occurred that the socialist countries and the Soviet country, the Soviet Union, collapsed, and the blockade worsened. With the existence of the Soviet Union, the socialist countries, we felt better. We were able to resist better, and our economy resisted through 30 years and was able to reach an extraordinary social development. However, at the time of the birth of the Cuban Revolution, there was no other alternative in a country under a blockade by the most powerful country in the world. That is why the elimination or the disappearance of the socialist countries and the Soviet Union represented a terrible blow for Cuba, because the blockade was not only maintained, but it was enhanced. So our country lost 70% of its imports. And I ask myself if any other country in the world could have resisted such a blow. And I also ask myself, how long could they have resisted? How many days? A week, 15 days, a month? How could they have resisted if it were not with the support of the people and the support of the people? How could we have resisted, truly resisted, if it were it not that our democratic system, without the direct participation of the people in the fundamental issues, which is, in essence, true democracy?
any other Latin American country could have resisted the brutal drop of 70% of its inputs? Could any other European country been able to bear or pass such a test? Politicians would have yielded even one day before. They would have capitulated. But we have dignity. We have a sense of honor. And we are dear to principles. For us, principles are more worth than life itself. And we have never, never negotiated one single principle. Look, when we were helping the Central American revolutionaries, the North Americans said that they would lift the blockade if we stopped assisting the Central American revolutionaries. We never even thought of such a thing. At times they said that they were ready to lift the blockade if we stopped assisting Angola and other African countries. And that possibility of negotiating our relations with for this had never came to our mind. At times they also said that they would lift the blockade if we severed our bonds with the Soviet Union. And we never dreamed of such a thing, because we are not a party or political leadership that negotiates principles, and at that price. The blockade would be eternal, because it is a price that we are simply not willing to pay. This situation then led us into the special period. We had been implementing excellent plans before this catastrophe in socialism. Excellent plans in all aspects. We were implementing a rectification process with respect to errors, negative trends, old and new errors and trends, and working intensively. When this debacle begins, which led us to what we could call a dual blockade, because once the socialist community disintegrated, and once the USSR disintegrated, even before that, the United States were already exerting strong pressures to cut the trade between these countries and Cuba. When the USSR collapsed at the end, the U.S. exerted tremendous pressure, and not unsuccessfully, by the way, in cutting trade and economic relations between the former socialist countries and the USSR and Cuba. So our country was caught in a dual blockade. However, we had to save the homeland, we had to save the revolution, we had to save socialism. We called it the gains of socialism, because we cannot say now that we're building socialism, but rather that we're defending what we have done. We are defending the gains attained. A fundamental objective in a world that had changed radically, in which the entire power of the empire turned against us. Because, for instance, in the case of China, a huge, large nation that defends the ideas of socialism, they have not placed any conditions on Vietnam. An excellent, a heroic nation. They have not placed any conditions on them. There is no blockade against them today. The blockade is only against us. So please try to place yourselves in the position of our party and of our leadership. And under such difficult circumstances that we had never witnessed before, to save the homeland, to save the revolution, and to save the gains of socialism, what measures were we to take in this world? The world we have at present, and which naturally will not exist forever. These are illusions on the part of those who believe that neoliberalism is a non plus ultra, is the ascent to the sky, or to heavens, and the eternity of heaven for capitalism. These are mere illusions. And the world will teach us many lessons of what will happen in this respect. It would be a long, long issue to explain, and it would take us too long if we get into this issue. But for them, this is eternal. And today, they speak of globalization of the economy. Let's see what's left of this globalization for the third world countries once all the defense mechanisms disappear and the third world begins to compete in technology with the huge level of development of the main developed capitalist countries. Then they will try to exploit the third world's natural resources more than ever before, and the cheap labor of the third world to accumulate increasing amounts of capital. But the matter is that that super-developed capitalism, such as that of Europe, for instance, has an increasing amount of unemployed. And the more they develop, the more unemployment. What will happen in our countries? The globalization of differences, of social injustices, the globalization of poverty. But this is the world we have, and with which we must trade and exchange our goods, in which we must survive. And that is why we must adapt ourselves to that world and take the measures we deem indispensable with very clear objectives. This does not mean that everything we're doing are things that are exclusively the result of the new situation. We had been making changes. Even this idea of introducing foreign capital came before the special period. We had realized that in certain areas, in certain branches, it was impossible for us to develop because we lacked the capital and the technology to do it. And the socialist countries did not have them either. But we have been forced to open more. We had to open quite broadly to foreign investment. That was explained here. In the conditions of today's Cuba, without capital, without technology, without market, we could not develop. That is why all measures, changes, and reforms we're implementing one way or another are aimed, as was said here, to safeguard the independence, the revolution, because a revolution is the source of everything, and the gains of socialism, which means to preserve socialism, or the right to continue building socialism when circumstances allow us. We are making changes, but without renouncing independence or sovereignty. We make changes, but without renouncing the true principle of the government, of the people, for the people and by the people. Which, translated to revolutionary terminology, is the government of the workers, for the workers, and by the workers. Not the government of the bourgeois, for the bourgeois and by the bourgeois. Not the government of capitalists, by capitalists and for capitalists. Not the government of transnationals, by transnationals and for transnationals. Not the government of imperialism, by imperialism and for imperialism. That is the great difference. Whatever the changes and reforms be, those that we carry on, if one day we were to renounce this, we would have renounced the reason of being of the revolution. We have been in solidarity with the world. It is not we that should speak of that solidarity. Solidarity, on our part, we believe that we should do the utmost and speak the least. Because we were not boasting about our behavior. But before we began the final part of the meeting, a comrade was saying, how many things has Cuba done? When one hears visitors speak of visitors from different countries, when they speak from Mexico, when they speak of scholarships, people, students that were trained here and different activities, one realizes that during all these years, our country has actually done many things. The question is that for us, solidarity and internationalism constitute a principle and a sacred one at that. And to give you an example, I will mention certain things. For instance, more than 15,000 Cuban doctors have offered their services free of charge in tens of countries during the revolution. More than 15,000 doctors have participated in internationalist missions as doctors.
Más de 26,000 maestros y profesores.
More than 26,000 teachers and professors.
Pregunto si algún otro país pequeño.
I ask myself, has any other country or even intermediate, grande, maybe large country,
han tenido
has
ese record.
Had this record.
Suffice
it to say that at a given moment we had three times more doctors working free of charge abroad in the third world than the World Health Organization. And we did not have large resources, but had minimal resources. We could only count on the honor of our health workers, their internationalist vocation. How many lives have they not saved? And I ask myself, is it fair to blockade a country that has done that? How many hundreds of thousands of children have we educated with our teachers abroad? We have not only sent professors of elementary school or junior high schools and even university professors, we have established medical schools in many countries of the world. Is it fair to blockade a country that does that? A country that has done that and is still doing it to a certain extent. Half a million Cubans have been at internationalist missions of different type. Half a million Cubans. Africans have been quite generous, very noble, and they have wanted to recall Cuba's idea, Cuba's solidarity, assistance here in the struggle against colonialism, in the struggle against foreign aggression, in the struggle against apartheid and racism. As I said here, our soldiers were fighting in South Angola. 40,000 men, 40,000 men, together with the Angolan troops, which behaved and fought heroically. But Cubans alone, in South Angola, against the South Africans after the Guito-Guanabale battle, and during our counter-offensive southwest of Angola, these men were even expecting an attack with nuclear weapons, and we knew that. And the distribution of the forces at that offensive took into consideration the possibility for the enemy to use some nuclear weapons. At a given moment, we had here 25,000 foreign students in scholarships in Cuba. It was the country of the world with the highest per capita in foreign students in scholarships. And we were not advertising that. We were simply Doing our duty, simply, as Martí taught us. And we did everything possible for the other nations. I believe that this extraordinary meeting, the noble, generous, and words of solidarity from you, are to a certain extent reflecting the history of solidarity of our own revolution. That has been a great incentive for us. It encourages us to continue fighting. There are great options now. The option of liberty, the option of sovereignty, the option of independence, the option of justice, of social justice. Social justice gains such strength as an idea in the midst of neoliberalism that is the denial of all principles of justice, that there are even some international agencies speaking of the Inter-American Development. The Inter-American Development Bank is increasingly speaking of the increasing need of social justice in this hemisphere. Even the World Bank is speaking of the need for social justice in this hemisphere. They are the champions of neoliberalism. And they speak of social justice because they realize that differences are so huge and are increasing. And they would love to conceive of the dream of a capitalism, a neoliberalism with social justice. They are afraid that poverty, hunger undermine the foundations of the neoliberalism that they're so greatly devoted to at present. And that is why they speak of social justice. But we know that social justice could only be applied by the peoples, and that neoliberalism and social justice are simply incompatible. They cannot be reconciled. That a superdeveloped world next to an underdeveloped world is something that is incompatible and cannot be reconciled. That those will be increasingly richer and the others will be increasingly poorer. That is a reality that cannot be refuted. Your presence here proves that just ideas are alive. That noble ideas are alive. That values are alive, and these ideas and these values must be multiplied as Jesus multiplied the fish and the bread. The church speaks of the option for the poor. And we believe that is excellent. But I believe that today's world needs a little more than option. It needs struggles, an energetic, tenacious, consistent struggle for the poor.
Debí decir iglesias en vez de iglesia. Ya que no se trata
I should have said churches instead of church, Católica. Since it is not only the Catholic Church.
Hace falta una lucha.
What is required
infatigable.
Is an indefatigable struggle
contra las causas que against originan la pobreza.
The causes that originate poverty. What is required is a struggle, an unshakable struggle against capitalism, against neo-colonialism, and against imperialism. Until the day when they stop speaking, when we stop speaking about billions of human beings that go hungry, that lack schools, that lack hospitals, that lack jobs, that lack housing, that do not have the most basic means to live. It is already some 6 billion people in this planet. In a century, it has multiplied by 5. That is the population of the Earth 100 years ago. Multiple are the threats suffered today by humanity, not only of a social, economic, political, military nature. Someone spoke here, I think it was Robertico, the fact that a war started today called humanitarian missions, efforts in favor of peace. The war threatens us everywhere. And interventionism threatens us everywhere. But the world is also threatened by the destruction of its natural living conditions. The destruction of the environment, which is a problem that is growing in the attention of the people, and that is increasingly moving and developing the awareness of human beings. The efforts that we must all make must be extremely great in every field in order to save humanity from all these risks. And what is the historical origin of this situation? Could anyone deny that it was colonialism? That it was neo-colonialism? That it was imperialism? Can anyone deny that it was capitalism? We are quite aware of that. Whatever the setbacks of the progressive revolutionary movement may have been, and the socialist movement, but we can tell you here, dear comrades, we shall never return to capitalism.
Ni al capitalismo salvaje,
neither will we return to that brutal, savage capitalism, whatever name Pérez Esquivel wants to give it, cannibalistic capitalism, a moderate capitalism, if that exists. We do not want to return to that capitalism. And we will not return. And we are aware of our duties and our obligations. We have resisted already for almost 5 years under very difficult conditions. When others believed that the Cuban Revolution would immediately disappear from the face of the earth. We are working hard, increasingly hard, and even increasingly stressing the subjective aspects, our own mistakes, our own inefficiencies, stressing the subjective elements so that the objective elements do not become a pretext for inefficiency. We must still make our people more aware. That is why we have to explain why it is necessary to collect excess money in circulation and all these measures required without shock therapy. Find efficiency in agriculture, in industry. I know it has been a concern. You have expressed here this question of the production of foodstuffs. I must tell you that we are forced to produce foodstuffs without fertilizers, without pesticides or herbicides, without fuel at times, resorting to animal traction, being forced to feed 80% of the population living in urban areas. We, contrary to China and Vietnam, have 20% in the countryside and 80% in the cities. Their case is the opposite, 75 or 80 in the countryside and 20 or 25% in the cities. We have shortages even of labor. Our agriculture had been mechanized. As many of our activities in the country, our sugar harvests, people were questioning whether to produce sugar or not. We have no other way but to produce sugar. We have to. Now then, it's more expensive if the sugar mills and the equipment produce less because of a shortage of fertilizers, for example. In general, we know how to produce foodstuffs. But we have been forced to face a tremendous shortage of the input required for the production of foodstuffs. We have had to develop other areas. Tourism was already mentioned here. It became a need that was not promoted in the initial years of the revolution. It has its good side, and it also has inconveniences, since we cannot live hoping to live in an ivory tower and participate in today's world's problems. We must believe that war comes out of vice, in the same way that excellent flowers at times are born from manure. We must get used to live with all these problems. We must find convertible currencies precisely to have these inputs. Cattle raising also was left behind without fodder, irrigation, fuel. The problems we have had to face are not easy, But we are facing them, doing what Robertico, I think, said, sharing the little that we have among many and not sharing a lot among very few. We have been sharing what we have,
and
under those extremely difficult circumstances, I repeat, not one single school without a teacher.
Ni un niño sin escuela.
Not a single child without a school.
Ni un enfermo sin médico.
Not a single patient without a doctor or without a hospital.
Mantenemos nuestro movimiento de
we have maintained
de la
our movement, developing culture,
incluso en
sports,
especial,
and even in the special period, we obtained a fifth place in the Olympics. That might give you an idea of the efforts we are making under exceptionally difficult conditions. So when the little that you have, you distribute among many, many things can be done. And there are many countries in the world that have much more than us, and they do very little.
Concluye este evento.
This meeting is coming to an end, actually, as a lesson that is unforgettable to us.
Y esperamos mucho.
And we expect a lot.
Esperamos mucho de esta
batalla. We expect a lot from this battle that you will now wage
junto a nosotros.
Next to us.
Para derrotar el bloqueo,
to
para derrotar
defeat
la
the blockade. To defeat hostility
con nuestro país.
Toward our country.
Para defender la
to
esperanza.
Defend hope.
No porque nosotros
not
hayamos estado predestinados
because we have been predestined
a ser esperanza.
To hope.
Nosotros no nos consideramos un pueblo.
We do not believe
un destino propio.
We are a people with our with a known extraordinary destiny. We are a small people.
Un pueblo modesto,
a
quien
modest
la historia,
people on whom history under these peculiar circumstances
de
has given the role of defending
lo que estamos defendiendo,
what we are defending,
nuestros ideales más sagrados,
our most sacred
derechos,
ideals, our rights.
Más sagrados.
Our most sacred rights.
Ustedes ven eso como una esperanza.
You see that as
nosotros comprendemos
hope.
Lo que significaría
we
para
understand
toda la progresista,
what it would mean for all progressive, revolutionary, peace-loving,
mundo,
justice-loving forces of the world
que el imperialismo lograra
for
aplastar
imperialism to be able
la revolución
to
cubana.
Crush the Cuban Revolution.
Y por eso consideramos
and that is why we believe it our most elemental, sacred duty toward you to defend the revolution
al costo de la
even at the expense of our lives.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much.
Infinitas gracias. Y permítanme
and allow me
exclamar una vez más
to once again
socialismo
say
o muerte,
socialism
patria o muerte,
or death.
Venceremos. Viva la solidaridad.
Long live solidarity.